Father, we thank you for this day, and we give you the praise, we give you the glory, and we confess all our sin today. We acknowledge all our need of you, and we pray that you forgive us, and we pray that you cleanse us today. And I just pray, Lord, as I make this video today, I just pray that you bless it for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Hi, folks. I'm going into Manchester today. I'm not going to preach today. It's going to rain today, so I'm going to go to a place, just drive out and just have some time with the Lord. And as I drive out, I'm just going to talk about various issues. And so enjoy. Father, we just pray that you bless. Just pray that you bless. This video for your glory, Lord. Cars on the either side, it's a bit difficult. So went to Preston yesterday. Preston University, had a fantastic time. Got a few videos of it. We went into the town centre and we had an amazing time. Absolute amazing time. The whole city was shaking up. People were coming out of the pubs. People were just absolutely coming out, and it was just amazing. Unfortunately, we didn't get it on camera, but I'm sure there were videos made. People were making videos, and you know, so you might be able to find a clip somewhere of it. It was absolutely amazing. So we had a good time in Preston, and it's fantastic yesterday. God really, really worked. Friend of mine who I dearly love, his dear brother, started talking to me about Calvinism last night, and he was quoting whosoever will, the verse where it says it's God's will that none should perish, and he was arguing that if I believe that God's will is cannot be thwarted, how do I explain that verse? But I think with the Calvinism Arminian debate, a good video to watch is the Matt Slick and Jesse Morell video. It's a really good video, and I take the side of Matt Slick. I think Matt Slick basically demolished Jesse Morell on Calvinism and Arminianism personally. I think that a lot of people misrepresent Calvinistic theology, and they don't really understand what they're criticizing. And that's what I felt last night with my friend, they'll not fully understand what we actually teach you. And secondly, you can't just explain texts that you find uncomfortable away. There are many texts that talk about God as a plan for the world, for the universe. And I would just encourage people to read the Westminster Confession, not because I believe what man says, but I just believe that it's a very helpful statement of Christian teaching on the topic of free will and God's sovereignty. So I just encourage people to study it. We've been going through the Gospel of John at the Hayward Presbyterian Reformed Fellowship. We've been going through the Gospel of John and looking at passages in their context. And when you do that, you can't get away from John 17, where God says, the Lord says, that, you know, Father, thank you for the people that you've given me. And that chapter is clear about in eternity, that God has chosen a people in eternity. So it's very, very clear. And I think the Arminians fail to see the depths of sin in people's lives, that they are blinded by sin, and it's only until God opens their eyes can they see. So man's will is in bondage. Read Luther's Bondage of the Will. Read John Calvin on sin. But I mean, a good debate to watch is the Jesse Morell Matt Slick debate, and personally I just want to get on preaching the gospel. But if brothers now want to talk about Calvinism and Arminianism, then I'm willing to do that, so long as we do it as brothers and sisters in Christ and respect each other. So I look forward to a few discussions with my friend and anybody else who wants to talk about it, but we should do it in a spirit of manliness and respect and love for one another. But I would encourage my friend and others to read the Westminster Confession and do some studies, and don't do eisegesis but exegesis. Look at the text in context that you quote. That's what I would say. The visit to the mosque I want to talk about. We visited a mosque, it was fantastic. We're going to be visiting the mosque again. And we're going to be visiting Muslims again and talking with them. We're going to be talking on the Quran, and we're going to be talking on other topics as well. I felt that we didn't know what we was getting into. We wasn't sure what we were getting into. We didn't realise it was going to be a debate. But I think we give them a run for their money. We made them think about the Quran. I've been doing some research recently, reading a PhD on the Quran by a woman in Michigan who wrote a PhD in 2010. And she's shown convincingly that when you look at the Arabic culture of the time of Muhammad, the poetry of the time, Arabic poetry, the documents that are presented by the Hadith collectors about Muhammad, political documents, that there was clearly a culture of changing the text. So when Muslims talk about oral tradition, it's smoke and mirrors, because once you get onto the text, the evidence is clear that they changed the text, they manipulated the text. And so there's a tremendous evil deception going on there. And I asked them in the discussion when we were together, we didn't get it on video this bit, but I asked them, have you got the names of the ancient Arabic text for your Quran translation in English, or your Arabic translation, your Arabic Qurans? And they couldn't answer, and it made them realize that their attacks on the Bible were mute if they didn't even know their own position. But we've got a few more discussions with them, and look forward to that. They're very nice people, and it was very nice. Incidentally, yesterday in Preston, we had one Muslim guy who was very, very nasty to us, angry, shouting at us. Quite frightening, but these Muslims were very friendly that we visited to their mosque, so that's a credit to them. I want to talk about pastoral care. I was talking to the Muslim imam, and he was saying that as a minister of his religion, that he would visit people. And I believe that if you're a minister, a pastor, you should visit people. You should go on a systematic visiting of people, and you should train up your people to visit. And I think a lot of people are falling away by the wayside out of churches because they just feel they're not loved. And pastoral visiting, shepherding the flock, is a great way to encourage people. So I just encourage you, if you're running a church, if you're leading a church, to visit people, because it means a lot to them. And your church will grow and be built up if you do pastoral visiting. Next topic. What's the next topic that I wanted to talk about? Yeah, I've been listening to the online debates and discussions online. I listened to a debate by Matt DeLonte with a young guy on the resurrection. And I kind of think that the argument for the resurrection, that it comes down ultimately to the testimony of the early church, the testimony of the disciples, whether those testimonies are believable or not. And it comes down to the documents that are preserved concerning that testimony. So I tried to strip it down. I tried to look at it from Matt DeLonte's point of view, look at it from a skeptic's point of view, and I've tried to doubt the resurrection. But a couple of things that bring me back when I doubt it is you can't get away, the skeptic cannot get away with the fact that there are these documents, the Book of Acts, the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke and John. And those documents, whether you agree with them or not, are quite significant and important in this debate and discussion. And I think if you allow those documents to speak with the content, for example, the Lord Jesus in the document says that, you know, he was going to die and rise again, that he was the Son of God, etc. So once you allow the documents to speak, it provides an interpretive context of the resurrection. And it's that interpretive context with the presuppositions of the existence of God that provide a context for the evidence for the resurrection. I don't think you can argue the resurrection without a presupposition in the belief in God or in the belief in the veracity of the text that you're looking at. I think it's more than just the resurrection. What I'm trying to say is the resurrection is not in isolation of Jesus's life. The two go together, and I think debates on the resurrection are not only Jesus's life, but in the context of the whole Bible and in the whole construct of what the Bible's about the living God. And so I think it's disingenuous to have a debate on the resurrection and not be honest about the presupposition that you believe in God, the presupposition that you believe in inspiration of the Bible. These do have a bearing on our understanding of the resurrection. So what I'm trying to say is that when the skeptic comes to attack Christianity, they're coming with a whole box of worldview tricks. It's their whole construct. They have a whole construct of worldview, a naturalistic worldview. And that is their interpretive box And so it's a circular argument. They're always going to come up with an attack. Going to come up with the conclusion that they want because of their grid, their interpretive grid. And it's the same with a Christian. We're always going to come up with our interpretive grid because of our construct, our worldview. So it's not enough. It's important that we provide the evidence for the resurrection, but we have to deal with this worldview issue. We have to deal with the clash of worldviews as well in the debate, I think. You know, it's not just about the resurrection, it's about the whole totality of atheism and the clashing with the totality of Christianity. And you can't look at the resurrection in isolation to each worldview. So you've got to dismantle your opponent's worldview as you get to the evidences for the resurrection. I'm just being intellectually honest, I think. There has to be some honesty there. Those are my thoughts, anyway. But I thought that I was quite impressed with the historical evidence for Acts chapter 2, and I think that one of the things in the debates about the resurrection is the debaters don't use the Gospels, and I think that's a mistake. I think you should use the Gospels in your debate on the resurrection. The Gospels are what God's provided us with for the resurrection, showing us the resurrection took place, and we shouldn't be afraid to go there. So that is a topic. But I've kind of read a lot of Gary Habermas and Lycona and a lot of the people on these resurrection debates and stuff, and continue to do so. I've been reading a PhD last week on John chapter 8, the woman caught in adultery. And for two reasons: one, to verify whether that's in the original text, and two, to understand the culture of what the Gospels were written in. It's very, very clear that the rabbis and the scribes, there was a written culture amongst the Jewish elite, a literary culture. And that means that when people say the Gospels were Chinese whispers, it goes against the literary culture of the time, that the disciples would have been people who would have been trained to write, because the rabbis were people who were authoritative in writing, and the scribes. And if you're going to be authoritative in that culture, you had to have some literary skill. And so in John 8, the Lord writes on the floor in the sand. And in order for him to negate his opposition, he would have had to have some literary ability. So the disciples would have been trained in that. So it kind of mutes the argument that it's Chinese whispers, the Gospels. They would have written the notes down about the Lord, and they would have been trained. And Paul, for example, was trained as a Pharisee, so he would have been trained in literary art of writing. The other thing about that PhD, Philo and Josephus mentioned the education system, and scholars say it's not about writing, but I beg to differ about that. So I think that's just straining at the gnat. The argument might go, well, Josephus, when he was writing, you know, his Jewish antiquities, you know, he didn't really know Greek. He had to have somebody to help him write good Greek. I mean, fair point. But it still stands what Josephus says, because the Jews would have been educated in the Torah, they would have been educated in, the rabbis would have been educated in writing and legal documents, etc., the scribes, the lawyers. So they would have had some knowledge of writing, and that's the main issue. And there was a bilingualness of that time. I mean, even when Jesus was crucified, it was put in Latin, Greek and Hebrew. So, but the passage on John 8, Augustine quotes it, Cyprian quotes it, Ambrose quotes it, there's an allusion to it possibly in Papias, which puts the quotation to around about of 150 AD. There's other allusions to it, there are some ancient manuscripts with it in. And I think there is evidence to show that John 8, what is originally part of the Bible, it fits the cultural context, looking at it fits the chapter context, and there is evidence there. So, you know, I think the King James Version is correct in its textual criticism, and I think that you should be aware of that, and you should not let Muslims or anybody else say the Bible's changed and then say that John chapter 8 shouldn't be there, because, you know, the information is quite clear that there is evidence there that it is, was originally in the text. So that's a PhD that I read last week. Online dating. I want to talk about online dating. It's dangerous. I went out with a lady, and a black lady from Nigeria, and went out with her, took her out for a meal. She was looking at other men while I was having a meal with her. And then when I got home, she phoned the next day, and she kind of like wanted £1,000 for a visa application to stay in the UK. She wanted money for her kids and stuff. So you got to be careful when you're going on these online dates. My sister went on an online date with a guy. She was, he was looking at her really strange. And he said, Tracy, I think you're lovely. I think you're really, really caring, and you're non-judgmental. Can I tell you something? And she said, yeah, sure. He said, I've been done for streaking three weeks ago. So, and then when he was talking there, she was, outside smoking a cigarette. He says, why don't you sit in the car? So she sat in the car smoking a cigarette, and he tried to kiss her by putting his finger in her mouth. And then, she said, oh, I don't do that sort of thing, what you doing? And then he started a car, he took her to Macho's, where he had a meal. And then he said, I've got something to tell you, I know you won't judge me. No, go on, I don't judge. Next thing you know, he says, oh, I keep thinking about killing people. So, anyway, she got home safely, but you've got to be careful when you... date people, you've got to be very careful. So I'm not doing any online dating anymore, so it's out. What else is there to talk about? The atheist and Islam. Besides, an atheist is getting a bit of bashing from Alex Barron and things like that, and to be honest, I find the online community the great debate community. I find it boring, it's stale, it's monotonous, it's the same old people saying the same old things. To be honest, I'm glad I'm not involved in that anymore. I just think they're wasting their talents and abilities. They need to break out of their box and do a few new things, like take a camera and do an interview at a university or church or do something different, you know, rather than just sitting on these Google Hangouts bashing each other. So I find it quite boring, really. But I miss people like Cliff Jumper, DPR Jones, Aaron Raff, Under Four. I do. Alex Bottom, Jim Garden. I miss these people. I do miss them. But you've just got to get on with your life and do whatever you have to do. So that's what I'm doing. So I'm here at a church where I'm just going to spend a bit of time praying. There's a meeting here. So that's where I'm at. But anyhow, they're all okay. I miss them. I think they're okay, really. And it's nice to see everybody getting on with their lives and doing stuff. And but I just thank God that I'm more productive in my life and doing more productive things than just staying on Google Hangouts and stuff. So we're here. There's a meeting in this church. So let me show you where I am. So this is the church. So there's a meeting here. I'm just going to have a day, Saturday, where I'm just going to pray rather than go out. It's supposed to be raining later on, some of the guys told me. So there we are. I don't know. So we're in the centre of Manchester. This is Brunswick Church. And yeah, so oops, just put that out. So yeah, so I'm glad I'm more productive these days, getting out and about and working with other people and doing stuff. Those years of being on Google Hangouts have gone now. So don't forget to check out my website, jasonburnspreacher.com, jasonburnspreacher.com, jasonburnspreacher.com. You'll see you can get on my website. There's loads of Bible teaching and stuff. And then you can go on Twitter, you can contact me on Facebook, and you can send me an email. You can get my phone number if you want to talk to me and engage with me. We're going to Hyde Park on the 9th of October. Three of us are going down, so looking forward to that. So I'm going to do some preaching there, and so I'm excited about that. So we're preparing for that. We find that the Muslim scholars down there fear us. They don't want to debate us, so I don't know what's going on there. They kind of run away. Not just me, but my brother who came down with me, and so I kind of suspect that the Muslim scholars down there will do some Aaron Ra chicken, man, chicken Aaron Ra chicken. You remember that? I think these Muslims are chickens, these Muslim apologists. But anyhow, we'll see if they come and debate us. But yeah, anyhow, we're going to Hyde Park on the 9th of October, and we're all looking forward to that. There's a team of us going down. We've got tickets and everything, so really, really excited about that. What else is there? It was my birthday the other day. I went to watch The Magnificent Seven. The Magnificent Seven, this time, it wasn't as good as the Magnificent Seven before. The Magnificent Seven before, they had more charisma. Steve McQueen, I just love Steve McQueen. I mean, he had just charisma coming out of his ears, you know. And so that they had more charisma in Magnificent Seven before the first one. But the Denzel Washington one, lots of shooting and stuff, but it was good. It was good. I enjoyed it. And I went for a meal at the Printworks. It wasn't as good because it's a Chinese come Indian, Italian. The food wasn't as good this time. But, yeah. What else is there? I did quite a bit of study a few weeks ago on hermeneutics and the philosophy of hermeneutics with at Yale University. I listened to a lecture there, and also studying ancient Near Eastern culture. I think that's at Berkeley. There's a course there at Berkeley that I started studying. And I started a course on physics at Yale, studying that. I couldn't understand anything really, it was really, really tough. Also studying ancient Greek culture, and you know, the thought that Western culture is rooted in Greek culture, and so I wanted to study that more. And then I've been studying a philosophy course at Wheaton College. You can get it online on YouTube. I recently studied the pre-Socratics, and it's interesting that just the same philosophical questions that we ask today, the same issues that we ask today, are the same questions that the pre-Socratics were asking, you know. So knowing the history of philosophy really does help you to deal with issues today, because the same questions were asked thousands and thousands of years ago. So, you know, I've been enjoying, got some text. So, yeah, so the questions of philosophy are asked. They're asked thousands of years ago. And so the questions that we deal with today, they're not new, you know. And if you grapple with ancient philosophy, it helps you to grapple with questions today. So one of the questions of the pre-Socratics was whether there was a mind behind the universe or whether it was by chance. It's fascinating debates, and I find that they're very helpful to know about those debates for today. I did a bit of research recently on evolution. I found out that recent research on evolution concerning our common ancestor to, you know, that we relate to apes. Atheists and skeptics said that we're 99% related to apes. But recent research shows it's about 46% to 60%. So that's looking at a variety of academic papers, so it's just completely not true that what the skeptics are saying. Also done research on language and the development of language and its relation to apes and things, and the studies of how we're trying to teach apes language and how massively different we are in our language capability than apes, and shows a differentiation there that evolutionists can't bridge that gap, and kind of shows us that the evolutionist is incorrect to say that we're common ancestors with apes, because there's such a massive difference between our language capacity and the ape language capacity. So that's it really. My walk with the Lord is good. Struggle sometimes with certain things, which is private to me, but I've never known the Lord as much as I know recently. The studies that we do in the fellowship, the Hayward Reform, Presbyterian Reform Fellowship, the preaching that I've been able to do over the year and the Bible studies that I've been able to do over the year, going systematically through books, has been a just absolute awesome blessing. It's been fantastic. You know, it's been absolutely amazing. Getting into the scriptures, teaching the scriptures, it's just been a thrill. And you can see some of those studies on the YouTube channels here and there. So that's it, really. I'm going to close in prayer. I'm going to go in this meeting. I want to say love to the online community out there, those who support me, and those who are my fans, those who follow me, what I'm doing. The atheist community, I want to say, hope you're okay, hope you're all right, Side 10 Atheist, hope you're all right, Aaron Ra, Thunderfoot, DPR Jones, Cliff Jumper, Fiona Robertson, Alex Botton, Wayne Hudson, Jim Gardner, Matt Dropout, Hogtie Champ, many, many others, G-Man, Bible Thumping Wingnut, Matthew 419, Live Life, No Plum, many, many, many of you out there that I used to have contact with you in some shape or form, Ozzy and his wife, and many, many others. Just love to you all out there. I'm doing great. I'm doing fine. I'm really doing what the Lord wants me to do. I applied to do an MA at a university in the UK. I could have done it. They were going to let me on the course, but I decided not to do it because I just feel that at the moment I'm doing the right thing. From time to time, money comes in. People give me donations that are able to keep me going. So God's good, and God's given me some good people to work with, good people to help me in life, in doing evangelism and other things as well. So God's been good there. So that's it, really. I'm going to go in the meeting now. And love to everybody out there. Have a lovely day and take care. God bless. Bye now.